Good morning. Doesn't the choir look great? Through the course of a normal week, it would be obvious to say that we pray for a service and that we pray for you. But I think this week we have been more intentional than ever before, praying that God would do something in your heart beyond human reason. And this is what I've been praying for you. And I've solicited the help of some friends who I trust will be praying, and they have been praying for you. Isn't that always humbling that there's been people praying for you when you didn't even know who they were? But this is what I've been praying for you, and several people have joined me in this prayer for you, praying relentlessly over and over and over this week. And what we have prayed is that we would leave this time with a greater understanding than ever before that without the resurrection, life is meaningless. And because of the resurrection, life has meaning. Without the resurrection, all we have is a random arrangement of haphazard events. But because of the resurrection, we have purposeful, clear, intentional mission. I've shared this quote before. It's one of those powerful quotes from a powerful person. Helen Keller once said this: worse than being blind is being able to see and yet have no vision. Worse than being blind is being able to see and yet have no vision. And my prayer for you that I want to pray here in just a minute is that you would be able to see the magnitude of the resurrection, that without it, there is no meaning in life. The resurrection is the only thing that gives your marriage meaning. The resurrection is the only thing that gives work meaning. It's the only thing that gives meaning and purpose to life. Without the resurrection, you're wasting your time by being here. Let me pray. Lord, we stand, I believe, on solid foundation when we proclaim the fact that you died on the cross for our sins, that you were buried, and that you rose again. All of it according to scriptures. Nothing caught you off guard. You orchestrated it all. The death and resurrection was not some cosmic accident, but it was a clear, intentional desire on your part to bridge the gap between us and you. And you were successful. And so we stand on that. And Lord, we pray that your thoughts would explode on our mind this morning, that you would surprise us. Obviously, some of us come with distractions. Some of us are just going through the motions. I pray that right now, every heart in here would just say, I'm here. I might as well take advantage of it. And that they would be able to see, that you would give them vision, that this is the most significant event in all of human history. And so, God, have your way with us this morning. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Death isn't something we think about very often, if at all. Wow, Dan, that's an interesting place to start. You just wrinkled my Easter outfit. That's not very positive. The remarkable achievements of modern medicine have pushed death further and further back in the average person's lifespan. We enjoy better disease prevention, better pharmaceutical treatments, and better emergency care than any society in history. And that's an incredible blessing, to be sure. But there's a side effect. The side effect in our culture is many of us can afford to live most of our lives as if death is not an issue and not a problem. And yet, death is no less inevitable than it's ever been. But many of us don't have to see it on a daily basis or don't even have to think about the daily presence of death in our lives. But death is still inevitable. In fact, to even bring up the subject is awkward and uninvited. Let me help you understand something, that our culture stands alone in that what we have done is that we have separated ourselves of most of history. Most of history where death was a part of life. People died in their homes with loved ones around them. cemeteries positioned by churches so that when you walked into a church, you purposefully walked through the cemetery. It was a visual aid that death was a part of life. Children were never protected from death so that kids would grow up understanding death is a part of life. It's not something to be feared. Pastor Matthew McCullough argues that when the reality of death is far from our minds, the promise of Jesus often seems detached from our lives. Fact is, when we avoid the truth about death, we are avoiding the truth about Jesus. You see, Jesus didn't come to make our stay on earth more comfortable and convenient. Jesus came to conquer the eternal consequences of death. French philosopher Blaise Pascal made an interesting observation 400 years ago. He said, men fear the most trifling things. They foresee and feel them. And the same man who spends so many days and nights in fury and despair at losing these insignificant things, well, is the very one who knows that one day he's going to lose everything because of death. But that same person feels neither anxiety nor emotion. Pascal goes on and he says this, and I quote, "It is a monstrous thing to see one and the same person at once so sensitive to minor things and so strangely insensitive to the greatest of things." If we were to take that comment, kind of modernize it, I think what he's saying is worry about things that don't matter dominates the landscape, and yet we block out the most significant things, which death is one of the most significant things. And as a result, we detach ourselves from death so that we can focus our time on energy and pursuing that love of self. But that detachment hasn't changed the fact that we're still going to die, and it hasn't made us happier. In fact, we suffer from being anxious and defensive and insecure and angry and despairing. This past week, I saw something on the internet. Al Davis, part owner and general manager of the Oakland Raiders, when asked about what he would like to do beyond football with all his wealth and riches, said this: he wanted to eliminate disease and death. Al Davis died in 2011. And we behave as if death, like diseases, can be eliminated. As McCullough points out, he says, people don't die because medicine fails them. People die because they're human. Romans chapter 6, verse 23 confirms that all of us is under a death sentence. And because of the fall, Adam and Eve sinned. And since we are Adam and Eve's descendants, we have inherited their sin nature. And the wage, what we get paid for our sin, is death, one out of one time. In Adam, all of us die. And the question that we must wrestle with is, why does our culture avoid the truth about death? Why does our culture avoid that all of us will physically die? Well, you know what? Death doesn't fit in our drive for happiness. Death interrupts our plans. Death brings grief and steals our joys. It cuts us off from our loved ones. Death says that we're not too important to die. So we avoid death because it's horrifying. And avoiding the truth about death makes sense if there is nothing we can ever do to change it. And avoiding the truth about death makes sense when there is no hope of deliverance. So we avoid it. We block it out. We sequester death away. We guard our children from it. We remove people who are dying from where living takes place. We take the dying to sanitize sterile places. We give glib answers to people's pain. We don't call it death. We call it passing away. We make people feel guilty if they mourn by saying things like, hey, your loved one is in a far better place. You ought to be happy for them. See, what I want you to understand is when we talk about God without facing death, well, we look past the reality of death. And there is no way when we look past the reality of death to explain the full implications of what Jesus has done on our behalf. See, if death is no big deal, if death is not something to be mindful of, if death isn't a problem, then Jesus isn't much of a solution. And the more we face the reality of death and the pain that it brings, well, then the more we will be able to come to grips with who Jesus is and why he came. See, what the world says about you, what death says about you, is that you're dispensable. And that's horribly painful. That's why it's the single most feared event in human history. Always has been, always will be. And if death says that you are dispensable, Jesus says, no, you are more loved than you could have ever imagined. And Jesus says, he says, you are indispensable. Because what the gospel says is that we are of great value, not because of our greatness, but because of the character of our God who has chosen to love us and rescue us. McCullough writes, only when I see his glory and recognize that I am utterly dispensable, am I prepared to be amazed by the message of the gospel. Who Jesus is and what he has done on the cross is the only one that makes life meaningful. So let's look at the message of the gospel this Easter Sunday. It's summarized in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 3 and 4. If someone was to ask you what's the gospel is best summarized, I believe, in these two verses. Let's read it. I'm reading from the New American Standard Version. It says this. Paul is writing. He's saying, I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, and here it is, that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures. If you were to take this sentence and put it into a modern sentence structure, you would put it into three parts. That Christ died on the cross for our sins, according to the Scriptures. That Christ was buried, according to the Scriptures. That he was raised, according to the Scriptures. Why all of this focus on according to the Scriptures? Because without the full weight of God's holy Bible behind it, that statement that he died, that he was buried, and that he rose would have no more weight than any sentence that you and I would come up with. But God puts the full weight of his Scriptures behind it. 66 books, written over 1,500 years, 40 different authors, 3 different languages, 3 different continents that it was written on. 40 different authors writing 66 books, and yet it's a unity of thought and theme written over a 1,500 year period of time. It is a beautiful conglomeration of God's love letter to us. And God takes his holy word and he puts the whole weight of his holy word behind the gospel. This book is totally dependent on the gospel. It talks about it beforehand. It talks about it afterhand. It talks about the consequences of it. It prepares us for the arrival of Jesus. It tells us that he's coming back again. It is held together by the gospel. If Jesus didn't rise from the grave, then this word would fall to the ground and disintegrate. And so God puts the full weight of this Bible behind that statement. Without the full weight of the Scriptures behind the statement that Jesus died, that he was buried, that he rose from the grave, then that statement would be anemic at best. He says Christ died for our sins. To start off with that statement, he says to die to our sins, to die for someone's sins, well, that presupposes that someone is in fact infected with sin. I'm going to make a strange statement. It might seem kind of a little outlandish. What if I was to tell you that when mankind came down with this sin disease, that God at that moment gave us the gift of death? Wait a minute, what? Easter Sunday, you're telling me that death is a gift? Preposterous. Go back with me in history. Let's take a field trip back to the beginning. Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. Adam and Eve, God's first created beings, man and woman. They sinned. They disobeyed. They trusted self over God. They exchanged the truth of God for a lie. They ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil when God told them not to. The one thing that God told them to do, they disobeyed. Sounds familiar? And sin comes over them. There was another tree in the garden till up until that moment was accessible. It was the tree of life. Anybody who participated in that fruit would live eternally. And God in his graciousness kicked Adam and Eve out of the garden before they could partake of the tree of life. It's recorded in chapter 3, verses 22 and 23. You see, had Adam and Eve eaten of the tree of life, all of mankind would have lived forever, but they would have lived forever in their sin condition. Eating of the tree of life would have enabled Adam and Eve and their descendants to live forever, but their nature, having already been corrupt, meant that if they ate of the tree of life, mankind would have lived forever in a sinful state. I want to live forever. You want to live forever. But we don't want to live forever in our sinful state. All you had to do, even this morning in the newspaper, those in Sri Lanka had already celebrated Easter. Over 200 died because 8 explosions went off in the congregations. The world in which we live is sin-ridden. You want to live forever, but you don't want to live forever with the sin and despair. You want something different. You want something greater. So by God allowing man to die, that was actually a gift. This death that every descendant of man would experience is the only way back to the place of a sin-free life that you and I call heaven. Death, physical death, is the punishment perfectly compatible to our offense. But it also sets the stage for how God, through Jesus, will eternally rescue us from death. So he says, Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures. Again, from Genesis chapter 3 forward, God's word tells of how Jesus will one day take away the eternal consequences of death by dying for our sins. Many people approach the Bible and they rest on the Ten Commandments, which is fantastic because the Ten Commandments we looked at last week is a coach. It coaches us to how we can't get to God on our own. But many times what we do is we stop there. And so we label the Bible that, you know what, the Bible, what it does is it just is full of telling us we're not good enough. I would push back because I believe the Bible is a story of God rescuing mankind from sin because man isn't good enough. It's a story of the greatness of God. It is not a man-centered story. It is a God-centered story. John Stott, British theologian, said these words. Listen carefully. He says, "For the essence of sin is man substituting himself for God, while the essence of salvation is God substituting himself for man. Man asserts himself against God and puts himself where only God deserves to be. God sacrifices himself for man and puts himself where only man deserves to be." That's why we can rightfully say that God, Jesus, went through an unjust trial so that we wouldn't have to go through a just one. According to the Scriptures. In the book of John, chapter 1, verse 29, takes that great account where Jesus now has arrived on his point of entering into his adult earthly ministry. And he sees John the Baptist, and in chapter 1, verse 29, John the Baptist sees him and says, "Behold," everybody notice, "behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." Why is he calling him the Lamb of God? You have to understand, for close to 2,000 years, God had set a precedent pointing people to one day there would be an unblemished lamb who would be slain. And in the Old Testament, what you would do is you would participate in an annual event that would represent the removal of your sins for that particular year, where you and your family would bring an unblemished lamb to the slaughter, this beautiful, cute, little unblemished, fuzzy little lamb. Have you ever seen them? They're just as cute as can be. I've often thought, wouldn't it be more appropriate to bring like a scorpion or a snake to be slaughtered for your sin because of its ugliness? But the innocence of the lamb would be taken. And life is in the blood, and so the blood of the lamb would be shed, meaning that your sin was so great that it demanded the life of someone else. But those unblemished lambs that were slain never saved anybody because it was pointing towards the fact that one day there would be a lamb that would come that would take away the sins of the world, a perfect lamb. And those little fuzzy, cute lambs always was pointing towards an ultimate day, and John the Baptist says he's here. He's the Lamb of God. He is the ultimate Lamb of God that will take away the sins of the world. Some 700 years before Christ even invaded the planet, Isaiah in chapter 53 says this: "He was despised, he was rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. Surely he's borne our griefs, carried our sorrows. He was wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities. By his stripes we were healed. How would Isaiah know that 700 years before Christ even came? Psalm 22, verse 7, describing Christ on the cross. All that see him laugh at him. They shout with their lips. They shake their heads. Coincidence that they predict these things? Isaiah 53, 8 says this, he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of thy people was he stricken. And then you fast forward 700 years to where Christ is actually on the cross, recorded in Mark chapter 15, verse 37 and 38. After 6 hours hanging on the cross, and Jesus, it says, uttered a loud cry and breathed his last. From Mark chapter 15, we don't know what that loud cry was, but you cross-reference it. John chapter 19, verse 30, we know exactly what that loud cry was. Because right before Jesus died, as he's hanging on the cross, and he shouts, "It is finished." It wasn't a cry of, "Wow, I'm glad that's over with." That was a cry of victory. It was a battle cry. It was a booyah. I have accomplished what I set out to accomplish. I have conquered death. I have died for death. Jesus orchestrated his life for this from the beginning of time. Jesus' death was, according to scriptures, Jesus came to die for mankind's sins because the wage of sin is death. Remember what Stott said, God sacrifices himself for man and puts himself where only man deserves to be. Paul said it best in 2 Corinthians 5:21, God made Jesus who knew no sin to be sin on our behalf that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. He died for our sins. According to the scriptures, he was buried. According to the scriptures, Isaiah 53, 9, 700 years before he came, how would they know this? He had done no wrong, never deceived anyone, but he was buried like a criminal. He was put in a rich man's grave. Coincidence? Right after Jesus died, in fact, on that day, recorded in Matthew chapter 27, 57 through 60, it says this, as evening approached, Jesus is already dead. Joseph, a rich man from Arimathea, who was one of Jesus' followers, went to Pilate, asked for Jesus' body, and Pilate issued an order to release it to him. Joseph took the body, wrapped it in a long linen cloth, and placed it in his new tomb. We've got the address. We know where he was buried, which had been carved out of rock. The question is, why in the world are we having so much emphasis to verify the burial of Jesus? Because the burial of Jesus confirms that Jesus, in fact, was dead. See, you don't bury people that are still alive. And if Jesus hadn't died, then his resurrection would have been false, and death would have not been conquered. Go back with me in that time. The Romans and the Jews who were antagonistic towards Jesus' teaching understood Jesus' pre-resurrection intentions. He made it clear. They knew he had said he would rise from the grave. In fact, I would say the Romans and the Jews were probably more mindful of that intention than even Jesus' followers. In Luke chapter 18, verses 31 through 34, he's with his apostles and he says to them, "Hey guys, gather in, huddle. They will flog me with a whip, they will kill me, but on the third day I will rise again." You don't make predictions like that if you can't back them up. Jesus, from before the creation of the world, orchestrated his death and burial. That Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried according to the scriptures, and that finally he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. Without this event confirmed in verse 4, the story would be meaningless. Jesus' death would be no different than any one of our deaths. But do you remember? Recorded in Luke chapter 24, verse 6, the women who had followed Jesus came to the tomb. The tomb is empty. The stone is rolled away. Two angels standing there say to the women, "He isn't here. He's risen from the dead. Don't you remember? They say to the women, don't you remember Luke 18? What he told you back in Galilee, that he would rise from the grave? Later on in Luke 24, 34, Peter comes to the grave because he hears, is he really risen? The stone is rolled away, it's empty, and Peter, oh my gosh, it's true. The Lord is risen. In John chapter 20, verse 13, Mary, nobody could question Mary's love for Jesus. Mary weeping. She comes to the tomb, it's empty. An angel is standing by the tomb, and an angel says to her, woman, why are you weeping? And through her tears, she says, who's taken away my Lord? Where have they taken the dead body of my Lord? And then Jesus graciously appears to her, and he says one word. He says, Mary. The lights came on. All the story was confirmed. Oh my gosh, she recognized his voice. She recognized him because he had been calling her name for years, Mary, and immediately, oh, it's true, you're alive. See, dead men don't call you by name. And Jesus has been calling people by name for the past 2,000 years. Jeremy, Kent, Don, Tim, Berger, Ray, Eric, Tom, Ben, Zach, Chris, and for whatever reason, Dan. See, apologists over the years have pieced together the story to show the confirmability of the resurrection. For something to be true, it must be confirmable. In other words, it must be substantiated through evidence. And when you piece the story together, it is flawless. It is perfect. Jesus, taken before trial, declared guilty, held them to their own laws because he didn't utter a word. Nobody came to his defense. He was beaten, probably face past recognition, with the butts of their hands. He was flogged. We know this by fact. Josephus even records it 39 times. With the cat of nine tails, it was a whip with nine leather straps with bone chips and lead tied into them. See, 40 lashes with the cat of nine tails was death. It would literally, the person would die. And so the Romans knew that 39 would be just enough. But since it was a Jewish rule to only whip somebody 39 lashes, the Romans, in mocking the Jews, would miscount many times. 36, 37, oops, 34. But let's just give it that he was whipped 39 times. Skin literally shred off his back. And then he had to carry a block. The crossbeam of the cross. We know what the crucifixion looked like. Horrible. It was not to kill somebody instantly. It was to kill somebody through long-term torture. And it was incredibly effective. He carried the block as long as he possibly could until he was crushed under the weight of it. And someone else, we even know his name, Simon of Cyrene. What a privilege to pick up his cross and carry it the rest of the way. Flesh nailed into wood, hung on the cross for 6 hours. It was approaching evening time. You see, people on the cross didn't die out of loss of blood. They died of suffocation because the process of dying on the cross was meant to prolong and be agony. Where a person, it was said, would push up on the nails on their feet to get a breath, but they couldn't hold it long because of the pain on their feet and would sag down. And the tautness of their upper torso didn't enable them to breathe very easy. And so what would happen is their lungs would eventually fill up with fluid. And people who died on the cross died because of suffocation from their own bodily fluids. Do you remember when the guards went to say, hey, let's cut this thing short? And what they would do is they would take their spear and put it between their legs and twist to break their legs so the person could no longer push up. But when they came to Jesus, they saw that he was already dead, and they pierced his side, because Psalm 22 had prophesied not a bone in his body would be broken. Coincidence. They took the spear, they poked it in his side to see if he's alive. He jumped, pierced right between the ribs, out came pouring the fluid and the blood separated. Two professional executioners signed his death certificate. They took his body off, wrapped it up in this gauze-type material, fine linen, mixing in this stuff called aloes and myrrh. It would have formed about a 110-pound cast over a body that we think was about his size. They placed him in the tomb, Joseph of Arimathea's. We know where it was. He had committed it. These people weren't stupid. They had it registered where it was. See, remember, the Romans and the Jews knew Jesus' predictions, and they wanted to cut this thing called Christianity off at the knees. And so what they did is they placed a Roman guard around the tomb. A Roman guard was not just a couple of guys with a couple of spears and miniskirts. These guys were trained Roman killers. In the same way that we train our Green Beret, these men were trained. These were warriors. And if one of them fell asleep at the wheel, if one of them didn't do their task, all of them would be burnt alive at the stake. These men were trained professionals. They were ordered to keep people out of this tomb. But they failed to understand it wasn't the outside they needed to worry about. What they couldn't do is they couldn't keep him in the tomb. See, that first morning, the issue in history was the tomb empty? That's a settled fact. The issue was, what happened to the body? Check your history. All of history says the tomb was empty, but the question now, we've got to explain it away, what happened to the body? Interesting, the theories of what happened to the body came about 200, 300 years later. Here was one of the theories, that the Romans stole the body. Well, if the Romans stole the body, remember, the reason they placed a Roman guard around the tomb was to keep him in the tomb. If the Roman guard stole the body, well, why wouldn't they just produce the body? Then Christianity would be cut off at the knees. But it's hard to produce a body if you don't have one. Similar story, a similar argument happened about 250 years after the cross, is that the Jews stole the body. Again, the Jewish leaders didn't want Christianity to be triumphant because they wanted to keep on to their religious system. Well, if they stole the body, all they would have to do is produce the body. Hard to produce a body that you do not have. Again, here's another argument. It's called the swoon theory. That's literally, you could Google it, swoon theory, and you could find out what it means, is that Jesus never actually died. This is the argument. Even though it says he was buried, you don't bury a dead man. Two professional executioners signed his death certificate. But here's how the swoon theory goes, that Jesus never actually died. Flogged, hung on a cross, placed in a tomb, wrapped with this body cast, 2-ton stone over the entranceway, Roman guard placed around the tomb, and then somehow he's revived. He breaks out of the cast, rolls the stone away, beats up 16 Roman guards, and goes about proclaiming that he's Lord of life. It takes more faith to believe that than it does in the authenticity of the resurrection. Scriptures confirm. He appeared to Peter, then to the 12, then to over 500 at once. And here's the most gripping thing that I cannot get away from. The apostles who followed him, that originally ran like scared rabbits, all of them died martyred deaths, proclaiming, confirming that they were eyewitness to his post-resurrection appearances. They all died saying Jesus legitimately rose from the grave. See, the accusation today is, that's easy to explain away. They died for a lie. And to be fair, people in history have died for a lie. But follow the logic. Nobody dies for a lie when they know it's a lie. Had this been a lie, these men would have known it, and they would have not died for a lie. Simon Greeleaf, law professor at Harvard, believed that no act in human history carries with it a more verifiable confirmation than the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And because of the resurrection, you are no longer dispensable. And God declares that death does not have the last word, the resurrection does. And through death, God raises us up and brings us back into relationship, the relationship that we were intended to have. And if the resurrection is not true, Paul says, your faith is worthless and we are still in our sins. But the resurrection is confirmable. Christ has risen from the dead, and therefore that which we fear the most, that which we ignore, that which we avoid, that we pretend away, is swallowed up in victory. Because of what Jesus has done, we can now join Paul in mocking death. And that's exactly what he does. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 55, he says, "Oh, death, where is your victory? Oh, death, where is your sting? I mock you. For sure the sting of death is real now. But the sting is short-lived. Because one day, very soon, you will be sitting in the presence of your king, and sting of death will be over." In 1 Corinthians 15, 57 through 58, the Apostle Paul builds a case for how now we are indispensable. He says this, "But thanks be to God who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your toil is not in vain in the Lord." Your toil, your work, your life has meaning and purpose because of the resurrection. Our existence has meaning and purpose that is God-given and secured by the resurrection. I want you to recognize so bad that left to ourselves, if Jesus is dead, everything is meaningless because everyone dies. But only in the light of the resurrection are we prepared to see how everything is meaningful because Jesus is alive. God, we have come before you this Easter service. Give us the capacity to see the magnitude of the resurrection. That you died for our sins, you were buried, you were raised, all according to the scripture. And may we come to know and realize that without the resurrection, life is meaningless. And the only reason life is meaningful is because of the resurrection. This Easter Sunday, I don't know where you are in your relationship with the Lord. If Christ is still dead, then you and I have wasted our time this morning. But since it is confirmable that he is alive, he stands at the door of your life. He doesn't want you to enter into a relationship with you because you have to, but because you want to. He's a gentleman. He died to pay the penalty for your sins, to take away the eternal consequence of your sin, and he invites you into relationship. And all you have to do is to surrender and say, "I believe in the gospel that you died on the cross according to the scripture, that you were buried and you were raised again on the third day according to the scripture, and I agree with that." Salvation comes through no one else but in Jesus and Jesus alone. Place your trust in him this Easter day and allow him to pay the penalty so you don't have to. Jesus went through an unjust trial so you would not have to go through a just one. Accept him. Believe in him. We have gathered together this morning in your matchless name, Jesus. And as a result, we have meaning and purpose in our life. And we love you not because we have to, but because we want to. And all God's people said, amen.
The ushers will take up the offering now. I just ask you to remain seated until that plate passes you by, and then stand and join us. To him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy, to the only God our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forever. Amen?
Amen.
God bless. You are dismissed.